Penguin Random House Audio presents The Bear and the Nightingale by Katherine Arden. Read for you by Kathleen Gati. By the shore of the sea stands a green oak tree. Upon the tree is a golden chain. And day and night, a learned cat walks around and around on the chain. When he goes to the right, he sings a song. When he goes to the left, he tells a tale. A.S. Pushkin. Part 1. Chapter 1. Frost. It was late winter in northern Rus, the air sullen with wet that was neither rain nor snow. The brilliant February landscape had given way to the dreary gray of March, and the household of Pyotr Vladimirovich were all sniffling from the damp and thin from 6 weeks fasting on black bread and fermented cabbage. But no one was thinking of chilblains or runny noses, or even, wistfully, of porridge and roast meats, for Dunya was to tell a story. That evening, the old lady sat in the best place for talking, in the kitchen, on the wooden bench beside the oven. This oven was a massive affair built of fired clay, taller than a man and large enough that all four of Pyotr Vladimirovich's children could have fit easily inside. The flat top served as a sleeping platform. Its innards cooked their food, heated their kitchen, and made steam baths for the sick.
"What tale will you have tonight?" Dunya inquired, enjoying the fire at her back. Pyotr's children sat before her, perched on stools. They all loved stories, even the second son, Sasha, who was a self-consciously devout child and would have insisted, had anyone asked him, that he preferred to pass the evening in prayer. But the church was cold, the sleet outside unrelenting. Sasha had thrust his head out of doors, gotten a face full of wet, and retired, vanquished, to a stool a little apart from the others, where he sat affecting an expression of pious indifference. The others set up a clamor on hearing Dunya's question.
"Finis the falcon, Ivan and the grey wolf, firebird, firebird!"
Little Alyosha stood on his stool and waved his arms, the better to be heard over his bigger siblings, and Pyotr's boarhound raised its big, scarred head at the commotion. But before Dunya could answer, the outer door clattered open, and there came a roar from the storm without. A woman appeared in the doorway, shaking the wet from her long hair. Her face glowed with the chill, but she was thinner than even her children. The fire cast shadows in the hollows of cheek and throat and temple. Her deep-set eyes threw back the firelight. She stooped and seized Alyosha in her arms. The child squealed in delight.
"Mother," he cried, "Matyushka!"
Marina Ivanovna sank onto her stool, drawing it nearer the blaze. Alyosha, still clasped in her arms, wound both fists around her braid. She trembled, though it was not obvious under her heavy clothes.
"Pray the wretched you delivers tonight," she said. "Otherwise, I fear we shall never see your father again. Are you telling stories, Dunya?"
"If we might have quiet," said the old lady tartly.
She had been Marina's nurse, too, long ago.
"I'll have a story," said Marina at once. Her tone was light, but her eyes were dark.
Dunya gave her a sharp glance. The wind sobbed outside.
"Tell the story of frost, Dunyashka. Tell us of the frost demon, the winter king, Karachun. He is abroad tonight and angry at the thaw."
Dunya hesitated. The elder children looked at each other. In Russian, frost was called Morosko, the demon of winter. But long ago, the people called him Karachun, the death god. Under that name, he was king of black midwinter who came for bad children and froze them in the night. It was an ill-omened word, and unlucky to speak it while he still held the land in his grip. Marina was holding her son very tightly. Alyosha squirmed and tugged his mother's braid.
"Very well," said Dunya after a moment's hesitation. "I shall tell the story of Morozko, of his kindness and his cruelty."
She put a slight emphasis on this name, the safe name that could not bring them ill luck. Marina smiled sardonically and untangled her son's hands. None of the others made any protest, though the story of Frost was an old tale, and they had all heard it many times before. In Dunya's rich, precise voice, it could not fail to delight.
"In a certain princedom," began Dunya.
She paused and fixed a quelling eye upon Alyosha, who was squealing like a bat and bouncing in his mother's arms.
"Hush," said Marina,
and handed him the end of her braid again to play with.
"In a certain princedom," the old lady repeated with dignity, "there lived a peasant who had a beautiful daughter."
"What's her name?"
mumbled Alyosha. He was old enough to test the authenticity of fairy tales by seeking precise details from the tellers.
"Her name was Marfa," said the old lady, "little Marfa, and she was beautiful as sunshine in June, and brave and good-hearted besides. But Marfa had no mother. Her own had died when she was an infant. Although her father had remarried, Marfa was still as motherless as any orphan could be. For while Marfa's stepmother was quite the handsome woman, they say, and she made delicious cakes, wove fine cloth, and brewed rich kvass, her heart was cold and cruel. She hated Marfa for the girl's beauty and goodness, favoring instead her own ugly, lazy daughter in all things. First, the woman tried to make Marfa ugly in turn by giving her all the hardest work in the house so that her hands would be twisted, her back bent, and her face lined. But Marfa was a strong girl and perhaps possessed a bit of magic, for she did all her work uncomplainingly and went on growing lovelier and lovelier as the years passed. So the stepmother..." Seeing Alyosha's open mouth, Dunya added, "Daria Nikolaevna was her name. Finding she could not make Marfa hard or ugly, schemed to rid herself of the girl once and for all. Thus, one day at midwinter, Daria turned to her husband and said, 'Husband, I believe it is time for our Marfa to be wed.' Marfa was in the izba cooking pancakes. She looked at her stepmother with astonished joy, for the lady had never taken an interest in her, except to find fault. But her delight quickly turned to dismay. 'And I have just the husband for her. Load her into the sledge and take her into the forest. We shall wed her to Morozko, the lord of winter. Can any maiden ask for a finer or richer bridegroom? Why, he is master of the white snow, the black furs, and the silver frost.' The husband, his name was Boris Borisovich, stared in horror at his wife. Boris loved his daughter, after all, and the cold embrace of the winter god is not for mortal maidens. But perhaps Daria had a bit of magic of her own, for her husband could refuse her nothing. Weeping, he loaded his daughter into the sledge, drove her deep into the forest, and left her at the foot of a fir tree. Long the girl sat alone, and she shivered and shook and grew colder and colder. At length, she heard a great clattering and snapping. She looked up to behold Frost himself coming toward her, leaping among the trees and snapping his fingers. 'But
What did he look like?
Olga demanded. Dunya shrugged. As to that, no two tellers agree. Some say he is not but a cold, crackling breeze whispering among the firs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.